today we have five of top Republican, actually top Jewish insiders, I would say, right? I said Republican, and obviously you're all smiling, so you must be a Republican. The first question I throw for all of you is, November 8th, did you expect this outcome? And most of you were either never Trump or not so much with Trump, and therefore my question is, have you come to grips with the election of Donald Trump? Lisa, go first.
Anyone who says they expected the outcome is the biggest liar I have ever met. That being said, I am personally extremely happy about the House and the Senate. And I think, you know, I'm not sure any of us were never Trump. I think a lot of us were on different campaigns. I was doing Jewish outreach for Governor Jeb Bush, who at one short point was the front runner. But, you know, right now, I think we're all in the kumbaya. I think Tevi said it well, or someone said a kumbaya mode, maybe. But yeah, I had no idea what was going to happen, and also thought we would lose the Senate. So very happy about that.
I definitely thought it was more likely than not that that Hillary Clinton would win, but I did think that there was a solid possibility that Trump could pull it off. And particularly Reince Priebus deserves tremendous credit. Reince, after 2012, the chairman of the Republican National Committee said, we need to up our game, get into the communities, talk to people, be engaged, and build a real ground game, not 6 months or 3 months before the election, but across the board for the next 4 years. And that's what he did. And up until Election Day, you had a lot of people on both sides wondering whether it was BS or not. We now know it wasn't. They built a real ground game. They delivered for Donald Trump and for our Senate candidates. I know the RJC did a bunch of grassroots stuff in key states. I was perfectly happy to cast a ballot for Donald Trump against Hillary Clinton. That was a no-brainer to me. Better on Israel, better on the economy, better on leadership in the White House and for all of us compared to the two of them. So that was easy for me to do. And I think it's really exciting to see that he'll have a Republican-led Senate and House to work with, and it's going to be very interesting watching those policy discussions as they form.
Well, first of all, smart move, Jeff, praising the incoming White House Chief of Staff, Reince Priebus. That was very good. He beat me to it. Second of all, if you want to talk about expectations, let's talk about the expectations of the GA, the General Assembly, the people who invited us for this panel. They expected us to be sitting up here in sackcloth and ashes. And we are not. If I had cigars, I would give them out to my friends here.
You're here.
I think we are pleased with the election. As Ron Campius, who's in the room, can attest when he asked me the question, I was not never Trump, but I was never Hillary. And I would say overall that we are very pleased with the results.
Yeah, I would probably differ a bit from my colleagues. I was never a fan of Mr. Trump. And I don't think he's going to be a very successful president. But I am very wedded to the cause of a conservative movement, and that is most at home in the Republican Party. What Lisa said is true. We have some excellent leaders in the party who were reelected against expectations, and I want to refer particularly to Senator Toomey of Pennsylvania. He's a fantastic senator, works across the aisle, is a true conservative, and hopefully he'll be a leader in the Senate to come. Listen, President-elect Trump has a lot to prove, and he knows it. He has a lot to show in terms of his campaign promises, and he has a lot to show in terms of his capacity for holding the office. I have severe doubts, but, you know, he could prove me wrong, and I'd be the first to say so.
I think we covered the whole spectrum, so I have nothing really to add other than...
Start the next one with Matt.
No, you guys covered everything.
I'll kick a goal to Matt, don't worry. Tevi, let me first start with you. You predicted early on in 2015 that this is going to be the most Jewish election because the leading candidates, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, had Jewish son-in-laws. Did you anticipate that this might be a little more Jewish than expected given what we had with Donald Trump's comments on Israel, his retweets, his right now, but we'll get later on to it, the appointment of Steve Bannon. Pretty much the Jewish community was very much involved. And what do you think, did you anticipate this?
So thank you for remembering that point I made. At the time I made the point, I actually didn't realize quite how Jewish the election was going to be because I did not anticipate that Trump was going to be the nominee at that point. So the election was more Jewish than I thought it was going to be. Obviously, having Jewish relatives of both presidential candidates is really new ground in American politics. But my larger point when I was giving that speech is that Jews have become much more involved in every aspect of presidential campaigning. And I went back to the 19th century where Jews were not involved at presidential level almost at all. I had a few examples. In the 20th century, they were more involved, more on the Democratic side, much more on the Democratic side, and also in specific areas such as speech writing and fundraising. But in the 21st century, we've seen multiple Jewish chiefs of staff, for example. We've seen Jews up and down the campaign. We've seen Jews on the media side. We've seen Jews on the political side. And now we've seen Jewish relatives of candidates. So I stand by my statement that this is going to be the most Jewish election ever. And I think it speaks to the comfort that the U.S. Has given to the Jewish community. And I've heard some pieces. I saw that Chemi Shalev had a piece saying that Jews should now feel like outsiders. I completely reject that notion. I recognize that there's some ugly anti-Semitism out there and even more ugly anti-Israelism out there. I think there's people on both sides of the aisle that are responsible for that. But for the most part, I think we in America have a happy home here. We should be very grateful to the United States of America. And what happened in Tuesday's election does not change that.
Matt, can you speak about what role Jewish voters played in this, in the outcome of this election, and in particular, what the RJC did to bring out that vote?
Sure. So the exit polls this year, I mean, it was very interesting because throughout the course of the campaign, you heard a lot of very smart academics and political pundits and operatives basically saying that Donald Trump was going to get the lowest share of the Jewish vote ever in history. And it turns out that based on the exit poll data that has come out, that he actually did in the last 30 years, he did about the second best, right under Mitt Romney, who did extraordinarily well with 32% of the Jewish vote in 2012. Donald Trump got 25%, which exceeded what George Bush got in 2004 even. So the dire notions that and predictions that were coming out that he was going to get the worst ever never materialized. And it never materialized for a couple of very fundamental reasons. Number one, the Jewish community or elements in the Jewish community really distrusted Hillary Clinton as it relates to matters on foreign policy and Israel and her support for the Iran deal. Seeing 8 years of a deterioration of the U.S.-Israel relationship under the Obama administration, I think for people who care deeply about Israel, provided a stark contrast between a continuation of that and a choice between Donald Trump, who, you know, a lot of people forget this, actually made a TV commercial in support of Prime Minister Netanyahu's re-election campaign. So I think that on that issue, it was a huge driver. I think this was also a change election. And, you know, the Jewish community in some ways is very different, but in some ways is very similar to the electorate as a large, at large. And, you know, the face of change is not Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton, if you look up status quo in the dictionary, is Hillary Clinton. And so I think all of those things combined, the RJC did a historic effort in terms of how we shifted some of our priorities this time, focusing exclusively on three battleground states, Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Florida. J Street released a poll that showed an exit poll that, and I don't usually agree with J Street a lot, but I will say I think that the data here is pretty solid, that they did a sample of Jews nationally, and they did one specifically in Florida, showed it at 28%. In Florida, our volunteers, we had multiple days of action where we empowered about 1,000 volunteers. We had constant phone banks and door knocking and had over 500,000 voter contacts, including a little over 200,000 contacts in Florida alone.
And the big thing that we drove home was the Iran deal specifically, because one of the things that I'm most excited about an incoming Trump administration is going to be getting their arms around and repealing this flawed deal with Iran, which is just an absolute unmitigated disaster.
Can I jump in for 1 second on this?
Sure.
I have something when it comes to American politics and the Jewish vote called the Troy Rule, which is when the Republican candidate gets over 30% of the Jewish vote, they tend to win the election. This happened to Nixon in 72. It happened to Reagan twice. It happened to George H.W. Bush. Now, Matt says that Mitt Romney got about 30%. So Romney wasn't quite high enough over that 30% threshold. Romney's other problem was that he did very poorly with Hispanics and Asians. In fact, got a smaller percentage of the vote with Hispanics and Asians than he got among the Jews, which is almost unprecedented. And Trump actually did 2 points better than Romney on both Hispanics and Asians.
I think what we're also missing here is that Romney actually got more of the popular vote than Trump did. So when we're talking about numbers and percentages, we need to remember that. I think it's also important to point out that there wasn't a Jewish effort like there was with Governor Romney or President Bush for Jewish voters. And I'm not sure that Jewish voters voted for Trump. They voted against Hillary. And that's what we need to remember in a lot of this election. Also remember that we never really heard about policy on Israel from Donald Trump. We heard a great speech at AIPAC. I don't know who wrote it, but it was very good. But I'll also say, as a former finance director for Mike Pence, that I think a lot of people trusted Mike Pence and trusted that he might have a larger role in this administration. And he's always been a very, very good friend to the Jewish community.
Can I just jump in? I have to disagree that we didn't hear a lot on Israel policy from the Trump campaign. I mean, they did have a Jewish effort, and I know the RJC was doing a bunch, but we had some very significant, one of the few things in the platform that the Trump campaign actually put their back into and pushed for, as opposed to leaving it to the delegates, was strengthening the language that we have in there on Israel to make it more clear that we will support Israel, and instead of forcing them into a two-state solution when there isn't a partner for peace, that we're going to stand by Israel in their judgment on whether the region is ready for that. So I think there were actually some significant statements by Mr. Trump and the campaign on Israel policy. And I think it was, I mean, you would know better from the ground, and particularly on the Iran deal, he was constantly talking about that and all of the other terrible deals that this administration had put forward. So I think there was, to the extent that there was policy substance in this campaign at all, that's one of the issues that did get a little bit more attention than I mean, this was a fairly substance-free campaign on both sides, and you know, in terms of what both sides talked about, it was mostly just yelling at each other as to who was worse, and a lot of voters did make decisions both ways on that. This was certainly an election that was about choosing the left, you know, who you liked more than the other person in comparison. I mean, that was the reality of what we were dealing with.
Noam, I see you're smiling. Would you want to chime in?
I'm always smiling. That's
that's good.
That's how I deal with life.
Only when someone's in trouble.
No. Right. Only when I'm about to offer you a job that you have to accept. The issue of how the Jews voted. I'm fairly skeptical of the numbers, and the reason why I'm skeptical of the numbers is because we just saw that the exit poll numbers were so significantly flawed. I mean, not just the polling numbers going into the election, but coming out of the voting booths, people still were not telling the exit pollsters what they actually did at a level of inaccuracy or a level of truthiness, which we should really be concerned about. The Jews are a very small subsection of the population. If insofar as we're going to be affected by margin of error issues, we're going to be affected by margin of error issues in a major, major way. So whether Mr. Trump did meaningfully better than somebody in the past or did worse than Mr. Romney, I mean, it's like, I don't know whether to believe any of those numbers, even though I understand that there are people who spend a lot of time thinking about this, and I respect those people who try very hard. I just don't think the precision is there. Look, insofar as this, you know, this campaign was not run with an eye towards the Jewish vote, or even towards the pro-Israel vote, which is a much bigger community, thank goodness. As Jeff said, it was run around the issues of character, fitness for office, honesty, trust, change. These are big, big, bold issues. And thank goodness the Jews typically think like every other American voter, and we're going to treat any of these issues accordingly. There are many, many Jews who are profoundly upset by Mr. Trump, as we know. You could just go out into this room and you could ask, and trust me, you'll get an answer. And interestingly, there were many, many Jews, less so, but who felt very strongly that Mr. Trump is exactly what this country needs, whether it's from a point of view of strength or a point of view of change or a point of view of the U.S.-Israel relationship. I don't know who to believe. These are Jews who I love, and they're on every side of the issue. I don't know who to believe. I think a lot of it will depend on how Mr. Trump handles some of these very significant issues. And as I often say, you don't really know whether somebody is pro-Israel as a president until there's a moment of crisis. Until there's a moment of crisis, you don't really know whether that president is going to stand behind Israel in a meaningful way. I believe that President Obama failed that test. I believe that President Bush, and to a certain extent President Clinton before him, passed that test. And so we're going to see how President-elect Trump handles that. God forbid if there's a moment of crisis, he'll have his moment to display his pro-Israel bona fides.
Lisa, as you mentioned, you led the fundraising effort for Mitt Romney. This year, according to 538, almost 95% of Jewish donations went to Hillary Clinton. Given the outcome, does that say that money doesn't play any more a role?
So don't ever say that. Don't ever say that to me. Money matters. I think, you're going to hear a lot of numbers first on what was raised and this and that, but what you're not going to really pay attention, what people should pay attention to, and people like me pore over FEC reports at night. Like, you guys are watching Housewives, I'm going over FEC reports. And what we're
While you're watching Housewives, be honest.
Exactly.
And what you're not going to see is, for example, if you look at Trump's numbers towards the last month, the last 3 weeks, they were down. And then the Ricketts and Adelson Super PAC came in, and his numbers went up, and they spent about $100 million. There's also a lot of other groups who spent money. So, for example, the NRSC, the National Republican Senatorial Committee, for full disclosure, one of my clients, raised over $100 million. And a lot of that money, yes, it went to Senate races, but it also helped with getting out the Republican vote. Another thing to look at is the great job that Lou Eisenberg did as finance chair over at the RNC. Lou Eisenberg is very, very prominent in the Jewish community. He's been a longtime Republican, and he led an effort that almost matched what the RNC did in 2012. As far as, the 95%? I'm not surprised by that. A lot of people in this election in the beginning gave to my former boss, Jeb Bush, and after that kind of didn't go so well, people kind of stayed out of the presidential. I think people were all over the place. So we had some folks with Rubio who did a great job, and Cruz who did a great job, but people kind of stayed out of it, and then they focused on the House and the Senate. So I'm not necessarily surprised by those numbers, but just remember, when you're looking at the numbers and does money matter, you've got outside super PACs. And also, one thing very important to remember, you have someone, President-elect Trump, during a primary, who got at least $500 million worth of free airtime. So while people like Jeb were paying for it, and people like Marco were paying for it, he had free airtime. That's unprecedented. I can't imagine that will ever happen again. But we need to remember things like that when we're thinking about these numbers that they just throw out.
Jacob, I think you should point out that the reason 95% of the money at the presidential level went to Hillary Clinton is because Lisa wasn't involved on the Republican side at the presidential level.
I love Tevi.
She did answer my phone calls, though.
I did.
Noam, Trump at the RJC forum said, "I don't need your money. You want to own the politicians." Given that money didn't matter at the beginning, do you think now that Jewish donors don't own Mr. Trump right now?
That's a very odd question.
It's a very odd question.
I don't think donors own any candidate, ever. I don't think that, with all due respect, I think money is a form of speech. It's a form of support.
I have seen it dozens and dozens of times. People support the candidate who they think speaks for them. They don't feel like it comes with strings attached to they can pull and push. Maybe I'm naive, but you know, perhaps I've seen it up close. Donors understand what their role is. It's to support the a politician as they're getting going, in order to make sure that that agenda that the politician represents gets enacted. I don't think there's any aspiration within any donor class to own politicians. I think it's a matter of expressing what they want to see happen. And I will emphasize this because this is very important for our Democratic friends or liberal friends in the room here. There's a lot at stake. The reason why politics is expensive, the reason why there's so much money is because there's a lot at stake, whether you're talking about the ability to wage war, the ability to spend massive amounts of money on causes of a special concern. The regulatory state is extremely powerful. It can tilt the field of competition one way or the other. And for what it's worth, if I had a lot of money, and I welcome all of you to contribute to my personal fund for that cause, I would take a great deal of interest in politics. Because politics controls a lot of our life today, which, by the way, is exactly what can explain, at least I think significantly, the results that we saw last week. People feel that there's too much power attached to what goes on here in this town. And that means that they feel that if they're left out, they feel like there needs to be a sudden, dramatic change. So when somebody like Donald Trump comes along and says, nobody can own me, I have too much money already as it is, it's a very appealing message. Whether it's true or not is immaterial. It's a message that actually works because it resonates with people who feel that Washington is too powerful, and if you don't have money, you don't have a voice.
Jeff, you led the, as we mentioned, the Apple campaign against John Kerry. Now, the only opposition research company that Trump had was WikiLeaks. Are you concerned that this is a form of democracy, that a presidential candidate relies on a hacking organization to expose his opponent? And my second question would be, where was this opposition research on Trump during the primary?
So I'll take, well, there's an easy answer to the WikiLeaks, which is, are you upset about the New York Times illegally obtaining Donald Trump's tax returns? That was illegal, but everybody still reported on it. The issue with WikiLeaks wasn't the stuff being sold, it was what was in there. If the Hillary campaign was not writing the emails and saying the kinds of things they were doing and manipulating the process to rig it against their opponent in the way it was, and wheeling and dealing with Wall Street and the rest of the people, nobody would have cared what was in WikiLeaks. We were told, we were promised by Hillary Clinton at the outset of this campaign that all we were going to get out of WikiLeaks was yoga and wedding planning. And that's not what was in there. And that's why it was interesting. That's why it was important. It had nothing to do with why should I, do I, would I encourage people to go and hack emails? No, but they set up a private server illegally and questionably in her bathroom in Chappaqua. They got what they deserved. Bottom line. And news organizations that had no problem reporting on New York Times and other leaks, the Access Hollywood tape, that was inappropriately leaked. I mean, you can go through, like, Watergate. I mean, you can go through the history of American politics, and some of the biggest revelations have been because of inappropriate and illegal leaks. So to try and pull out WikiLeaks and say, well, this is beyond the pale, I think is a little ridiculous. In terms of why there wasn't more opposition research done on Donald Trump early on, and this is where I'll probably annoy some of my colleagues that worked for some of the primary opponents, is they didn't invest in it.
That's not true. Even before
Donald Trump was in the race, I remember talking to a number of the campaigns early on. They did not hire serious research professionals at senior levels.
Nope.
They did not. They did not put. I'm sorry, but you didn't. You didn't. You, your research director was in, was at the JEB campaign was three had 3 years of research experience. That's a joke.
Right
That's,
to Rise that, spent $30 million opposing Trump. If you look at all the primary debates,
okay, hold on a second. I'm
Jeb
not talking about. I'm not talking about money.
Nobody
hold on
cared.
A second. Hold on a second. I'm not talking about money spent. I'm talking about the fuel for the fire of research. I'm talking about putting the actual substance together. Where was the Access Hollywood tape? Where were the business records? Where
NBC.
Were all the other things?
NBC
I'm
owned
sorry,
Access
but this
Hollywood.
Was political malpractice by every single other primary opponent in the campaign, even before Donald Trump was in it. They all had the attitude that somebody else had to beat up someone else, so they didn't need to do it. This cycle was the biggest step back in opposition research that I have seen in the more than 15 years I've been involved in presidential politics. They were not ready from day one. They did not take research seriously. They thought it's a big field and everybody will whittle it down. And then they were afraid to attack Trump when he got in, and they didn't have the material to do it, even if they didn't.
That's absolutely not true.
And you can just look at the money they spent. You can look at the personnel that they hired. They didn't have research teams that could seriously do this. They left it to Hillary Clinton to do it. It was political malpractice of the first order. And you saw it in February when they finally started to catch up and attack him in the debates. And everyone says, where was all of this 6 months ago when it could have made a difference?
Not true. 100% not true. Let me say a couple things.
Go
first,
look at your FEC reports.
First, no, actually, go. If you guys want to Google Right to Rise ads, and you will see ads.
I'm not talking about output. I'm talking about input.
Let me continue. Right to Rise ads that were Jeb Bush's super PAC were against Donald Trump. But I want to make a statement first on WikiLeaks. I think it's a very slippery slope to say it's okay or it's the new norm to see hacked emails. I've worked on two presidential campaigns, and if someone hacked my email, they would hate me. We all email private things, so I think it's a very, very slippery slope to say, well, it's okay, and maybe the New York Times published. I absolutely disagree with that. As far as attacking Donald Trump, the fact of the matter is Jeb did constantly. Jeb wasn't the best messenger to do it. We know that. But he did attack him. But what we also noted was that every time we attacked him, it backfired on us. If you also watch the debates, all 50 bazillion of them, you'll note that towards the end, Christie attacked and Rubio attacked, and it also backfired on them as well, but they waited till the end. The other candidates did not attack. As far as NBC and the Access Hollywood, that wasn't a tape. That was a tape that NBC owned, so there wasn't a lot we could get out of it. What we put out, what we got out there, was things that we thought would matter.
It was leaked to the Washington Post. The NBC News did not report that.
They were planning to, but they couldn't get their act together because of Rosh Hashanah, apparently. That's a real story.
Okay, now back to President-elect Donald Trump. Jeb Bush called him, so we are all good, right?
Yeah,
Matt, we saw reports yesterday, and we saw statements coming out in the morning of leading Jewish organizations calling on Trump to fire his newly appointed senior advisor, Steve Bannon. And this was an issue during the campaign. The ADL has spoken out against it. My question is, do you think that Trump addressed the issue in a meaningful way? And what would you say would be the appropriate response that President-elect should do now that 71% of the Jewish community voted against him and they are concerned seeing such a person serving at a top position in the White House? Did Trump do enough to address the issue of anti-Semitism in this race? And by appointing Steve Bannon, how do you think he should, going forward, address this issue of concern among American Jews?
Well, first of all, on the issue of anti-Semitism, I think it's very clear Donald Trump has been very explicit about condemning anti-Semitism and standing up against that. As for the issue of Steve Bannon, I've never met Steve Bannon. I've never talked to Steve Bannon. There's a lot about Steve Bannon that I don't know, and I look forward to the opportunity to have to sit down with him, with our leadership, and get to know him further, and as we begin figuring out how to work together in the upcoming administration. So there's a lot there, just because we haven't had the relationship, that I don't know. Let me tell you what I do know about Steve Bannon. The people who have worked for Steve Bannon, Joel Pollack, who is the editor of Breitbart, who is a kippah-wearing Orthodox Jew. I spoke to him today. He said that there is absolutely not an anti-Semitic bone in Steve Bannon's body. Ben Shapiro, who Steve Bannon has had a very public, difficult relationship with, came out today and was very clear that Steve Bannon is not anti-Semitic. We know that Breitbart has been unabashedly pro-Israel in their writings. We know they have been vociferously against the Iran deal. We know that under Steve Bannon's leadership, Breitbart opened an office in Jerusalem. So that's what we know. And there's a lot of stuff out there that I think really we need to take a step back and see, you know, see how Steve Bannon and this whole issue works out. What we also know is the folks that Donald Trump is also surrounding himself with. I have known Reince Priebus for about a decade. Reince Priebus is one of the most decent, honorable people that I know. He will be a phenomenal chief of staff. He is somebody who has terrific relations with the Jewish community, somebody who is strongly pro-Israel, and somebody that the Jewish community will be able to work very, very closely with. I think the notion that all of these press releases and all of these press comments about how involved the family is, we know that the president-elect's daughter and son-in-law are both observant Jews. The notion that they would knowingly put in somebody who they felt would be anti-Semitic, I think, doesn't make logical sense. So I think we need to take a step back, and despite all the press releases and all the back and forth, let's see what evolves and let's see what happens. And when we have more information and more data sets, then we can make a more informed decision.
Tevi, who do you think will be Donald Trump's Karl Rove or Valerie Jarrett in this White House?
I think there are a couple of people who have that capacity. I would look to Kellyanne Conway, who came on, did a really great job with the campaign, supposedly, I guess, took the iPhone away for the last 10 days. She understands polls. I've known Kellyanne for a long time. She's an excellent pollster. She understands politics. And I think from the political guru perspective, I think she'd be great. I don't know what role she's going to get, but it's pretty clear to me that she will get a senior White House role.
But if I can just jump in, which only adds to what Matt said, the reality is that the person who's going to play that Karl Rove, Valerie Jarrett, last person in the room, gut check, I know you better than yourself, and I can tell you, you know, his famous story about Valerie Jarrett being the only one that could yell at Obama to get out of the car and give one more speech on the campaign when he was tired of giving him and all the rest of it. The person who has that relationship is his son-in-law, Jared Kushner and Ivanka. And those, I think, are going to be the people playing the Valerie Jarrett, Karl Rove role as it relates to things, which only, to me, makes the concern that some have expressed a little bit less serious and more seemingly politically motivated.
Elliot Cohen, who was the ringleader of national security experts in a letter opposing Trump twice during the primary and during the election, wrote a piece over the weekend saying, I'm not going to serve in a Trump administration, but I urge my colleagues to do so. Now, we all know you all have jobs right now. Given that, if you are asked to serve, would you serve in a Trump administration? And if not, why?
What?
Answer the question.
I'm not sure I'd ever be asked. I mean, like I said, I used to work for Mike Pence. I was his finance director. I mean, maybe if Vice President-elect Pence. But listen, they have 4,000 jobs to fill. They need to fill these jobs, and they need to fill them with good, experienced people. And a lot of those people who have experience were people who were anti-Trump or on the other team. But the fact of the matter is, I think there was an interview with Henry Kissinger that I think you guys published saying, kind of, we got to see what it's like. A lot of these questions that you're asking, I find a little difficult to answer because this is a candidate we really know nothing about. We really don't, and I'm not saying that in a necessarily bad or good way, it's just, it is what it is. We don't really know what's going on. We don't really know where he stands. We don't really know where the people are. And so it's a learning experience for a lot of us. And I think that's why a lot of us, including Kissinger, are saying, you know what, let's see what happens. So.
Well, I have 10 awesome, amazing employees at Delve, DelveDC.com. We're a great company for all of your competitive intelligence needs. I can't, you know, it would be very difficult for me to step away from the business and go back in, but obviously, you know, it's always an honor to be served, even if all you thought was you were getting a cup of coffee with Noam. You know, and next thing you know, you're Jewish liaison, but it's a very expensive cup of coffee. But, you know, you can never say never. I mean, if your president asks you to serve in a capacity that makes sense for your skill set to help them achieve a shared policy vision, then you have to consider it.
Everybody's decision about whether to serve is based on a whole bunch of complex individual factors. I know when I served in the White House, I did not see my children from Sunday night until Friday night. That wasn't some weeks, that was every week. So there's a whole bunch of things that go on with each person in making that determination. That said, I would not issue any kind of blanket declaration saying that Republicans shouldn't serve in this administration. I admire Elliott's thing, which I read about in Jewish Insider, by the way, and I thought it was interesting that he said those two additional things, which is you shouldn't recant anything you'd said previously, and you should have a signed letter of resignation with you that's undated that you can submit at any time. I would submit that those are those are good pieces of advice to serving in any administration. You bring who you are with you, and you should be ready to resign when you think that the administration doesn't correspond to your values and your beliefs.
Yeah, these are excellent answers, and I agree with all of them.
Some policy issues. Matt is RJC.
I would not go into the only thing that I am even remotely qualified for is Jewish liaison, and I can never be as good as these guys. So there's no chance of me taking
true,
that on.
That's not true, Matt. There are so many other jobs you could do. Don't worry about it.
Presidential food taster.
There's some wonderful jobs with brooms and mops. You'll be fine. Don't worry about it.
Trump advisor Walid Faris said over the weekend that Trump is not going to move the U.S. embassy to Jerusalem. He's also not going to rip up the Iran deal. Now, that was a...
Hold on, is that what he said?
It's not really what he said.
What did he say?
He didn't say that. He said something different than that. This is what I did, by the way, I'm making this point because there's so many gross generalizations about what people say, what they said, what they are, who they are. What did he say? He said, we're not going to move the embassy right away. Okay. So he's walking it back. I get that. And in terms of the Iran deal, he said, we're going to look at it. We're not going to rip it up. We're going to look at it, and we obviously have problems with it, and we're going to examine it. These are different things. And by the way, this is what happens when you govern. You actually have to begin to fill in the lines in between, you know, what your campaign promises are and where reality is. And you have to find what you're comfortable with doing. And you know, this is precisely the kind of question which you like to ask.
Mainstream media.
No, it doesn't matter. It's not mainstream or whatever stream. It's a false hypothetical. Which and it's not a serious question. The question really is, and I'm going to correct you on it, is do you think that Trump will move the embassy to Jerusalem? I would say more likely than not. I think that he would be more likely than any prior president to move the embassy to Jerusalem because I think he's likely to look at the fictions and the diplomatic myths that surround that whole issue and say, you know what? What's the difference? You know, it's the capital of the country. It's where their seat of government is, where their prime minister is. We should be there too. We're their closest ally. We should have our embassy right there. And he would just, you know, I could see him as a character issue, just say, what's the point? And everyone would have to react to that.
Everyone would have to react to that.
And
that's the appealing thing of Trump, right? That he would just say, why are we living with these fictions? Why not just do what we always want to do?
Let me add something quickly on this. Which is, first of all, the 50th anniversary of Jerusalem's reunification is coming up in 2017, so that could be a good opportunity. But secondly, and more importantly, is that if I were president or advising a president and this question of moving the embassy came up during the transition period, I certainly would not signal my intentions, and I'll tell you why. President Obama is still president until January, and who knows what kind of mischief he could cause if he didn't like that decision that President-elect Trump were to announce. So I think it's smart to hold your fire about what the specifics that you're going to do in order to wait until you actually have the reins of power.
I'll finish my question. My question would be, if Noam wouldn't interrupt me, what would be the ramifications if Trump does not follow through and does not move the U.S. Embassy to Jerusalem? People put so much hope that this time it would be done. Matt, what would be the ramifications if it does not
The guy was elected less than a week ago. He has not been sworn in. Can we put this to the GA in 3.5 years, and when it's re-election time? This is a, let's. I think there's a lot to focus on, but the what ifs and these hypotheticals and these, scenarios is just.
Can we be honest for a second? Every single person that's been president says they're going
to
move it, and then they show.
But I actually think
the ramifications are nothing.
No, but I actually think that what Noam said, I actually think he's going to do it. I actually think he's going to do it.
I do think he's more likely than any of them, because what happens is they get elected, all the State Department bureaucrats come in. I worked with them for a year. They come in and they do all these dire conventional wisdom things that everyone in Washington thinks are true, and some of them have gray beards, and they use their middle name and first initial and are very WASPy. And they stroke their beards and they say, well, if you move it, it'll upset all these things. I don't see Donald Trump having any patience for any of that. He has broken through so many different conventional wisdom barriers that more than any other president in my lifetime, I believe that if someone's going to do it, it would be him.
Another question to you, Matt. Israeli.
I just answered the last question.
Another one. Israeli Ministerial Committee yesterday voted on a new law which would legalize illegal outposts in the West Bank. Now, given that you are a supporter of the two-state solution, and most probably most of you are because you served in an administration who supported an independent Palestinian state, are you concerned that the Israeli government and the Trump administration would move away from that commitment to a two-state solution, and what could it be the impact in dealing with the Arab world, with Iran deal and so on?
Well, let me be very clear, because organizationally we support the position as articulated by Prime Minister Netanyahu, who supports a two-state solution. So to the extent that the policy of the Israeli government is committed to that, we have historically as an organization taken a position that we support the policy of the Israeli government. So there is no daylight between the RJC and the position of Prime Minister Netanyahu on this issue.
Tevi?
Can I just say that I was part of an administration that did establish this policy of the two-state solution, provided that the Palestinians live up to certain responsibilities and obligations. So just to say mindlessly, two-state solution is if you could impose it from above and then the Palestinians could continue inciting hatred against Israel, that is not acceptable. It has to be under certain conditions if they live up to their responsibilities.
And I would also add, we also served in an administration that, even though the Obama administration likes to deny it, recognized for the first time, very importantly, the outcomes of natural growth along the borders and the need that you cannot just go back to the 1960s borders, because that doesn't match the facts on the ground anymore.
Final question before we open up to questions. It's a twofold question. How long will the Israeli honeymoon with Trump last? And if it does last, what does it mean in long term of putting Israel as a partisan issue as the Democratic Party moves towards left?
I don't even know what you mean by a honeymoon with Israel. I think the Israeli public accepts the election results, which is to their credit. I think we should all accept the results that occurred last week. And it is in Israel's great benefit to have a close relationship with the United States of America, particularly with its elected leader and its elected leaders. And Israel, to its credit, I think, has invested significant effort into touching every element of the American political spectrum to make sure that all Americans understand that Israel is of profound value to the United States, and for strategic reasons, for value reasons, for economic reasons. And I think that argument has been won over and over and over again. Even the progressive left, which is hostile to Israel, has a very tough time making any kind of inroads with regard to demonstrating its natural animosity towards Israel. And that's partly because it's a losing argument. It's, you know, I wouldn't want to make that argument if I were them. But there is a real risk that as Trump, look, I mean, if Trump takes a position which is distinctly different from what I would call a broad mainstream of positions that have been held by prior American presidents, if he's moved significantly away from those pretty wide margins, it's a possibility that it becomes even more politicized than it is today. And I fully expect that the anti-Israel cause in the United States, which is a very small minority of the progressive left, that they will seek to parlay the stronger animus towards Trump and wrap their cause around that anti-Trump cause. In fact, we've already seen it. The protests and some of the anti-Trump protests we've seen in New York and Portland, Los Angeles, Detroit, Denver, have seen anti-Israel rhetoric featured prominently. This does not happen by chance. It is absolutely part of a strategic effort by the anti-Israel left to turn the anti-Trump movement into an anti-Israel movement. This is very dangerous. This is going to cause a lot of people in this room a lot of trouble, a lot of agita. And, you know, we can deal with it in lots of different ways, but the first thing we have to do is recognize it for what it is, which is it's just like what they tried to do with the Black Lives Matter movement. They tried to implicate a issue of racial justice or racial injustice, as the case may be, into a completely different context, which is the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. We will see this at a higher level on steroids, and for Jewish liberals in particular, pro-Israel liberals in particular, this is going to be a cause of great distress.
Anyone of you want to chime in?
I would just quickly add that I have a slight disagreement with Noam when he said that the anti-Israel left is a very small portion of the overall left. I think it's a growing part of the left and a worrisomely growing part of the left. And I know you mentioned WikiLeaks is somehow it's out of bounds to learn anything from that, but I learned something very valuable when Robbie Mook said to Hillary Clinton that she should not speak about Israel to a group of leftist activists because they are so hostile to Israel. So I do worry about this issue.
Yeah, I agree. It is a real problem. And you know, something to watch is, you know, this may very well come to a tipping point and get exacerbated with the election of the new DNC chair, which some of the candidates they're talking about clearly have their foot in that progressive left-wing camp.
Okay, we'll take some questions in the remaining time. This woman, she was anxiously waiting.
Jennifer Mizrahi from Respectability. You guys are awesome, and congratulations. Whether you like or don't like this new president, you guys really fight for good issues, so thank you. I want to ask about voters with disabilities. Mr. Trump did not exactly run as the pro-disability candidate. I'd like to know how America's 56 million people with disabilities, many of whom voted for Mr. Trump, we'll find this administration, and how can we as a community position ourselves with the new Trump administration and the Republican House and Senate?
Look, there's a lot of important positions within the government, especially at HHS, Department of Health and Human Services, that deal with disabilities, and I would like to see some appointments in that regard who have knowledge about these issues, but are also people with disabilities themselves. And so I think, again, as we were saying earlier, that he's only been president-elect for 5 days, some of these issues have not yet come to the forefront. I will take a wait-and-see approach on that issue, but I really do want to see some strong appointments in that area because of the important concerns that you raised, Jennifer.
Anyone else? Or
hi. We're at a conference with a lot of Jewish professional organizations that have had literal weeping over the outcome of this election. I mean, actual...
Literally what?
Weeping. Actual tears. As we look at how these organizations are going to interact with the Trump presidency and are going to interact with the administration, knowing kind of the philosophical background that they come from, what's the best way forward so that these Jewish organizations still have a voice and a presence? Or do you think we just need different RJC type organizations to do the communicating?
Hey, well, I'll take that one. When I was Jewish liaison, I think actually I got this advice.
Are you running for RJC chairman?
I don't think the job is open.
Give Tevi's advice.
Yeah, no. I think I took Tevi's advice on this, or perhaps I'm ascribing it incorrectly to him. But when I was Jewish liaison, a job that I inherited from Tevi, you know, he basically said, "Look, there's a number. Most of the Jewish community voted against our guy. Most of the organizations are really not with us on a policy basis, and culturally speaking, they're not really comfortable with us." Okay. So much is the same right now with an incoming Trump administration, I think it's safe to say. The way we would approach it is, generally speaking, if we could find some area where we could work together. If it was 10% of their agenda, you know, corresponding with 10% of our agenda, I'd focus on that. And that's what we did. I mean, you know, I worked with David Saperstein on the issue of human trafficking. We worked with Saperstein on Sudan, right? That was under your watch.
You know,
HIV, AIDS, and PEPFAR. I mean, there are always going to be issues where the administration, any administration, can work with really anybody in the Jewish community. There may be some Jewish organizations that will never, ever want to do anything with Mr. Trump, and I understand that too, but there's always going to be opportunities. Now, the advice I would give to any Jewish professional, any Jewish leader, lay leader, or professional staffer, I would say, first of all, take the measure of the man and the administration carefully, accurately, know who you're talking to and know the issues and know where they stand. Don't just read, you know, characterizations of people. Get to know them. Give them a chance. I know that's hard to do in the immediate aftermath of an election, but it's worth your time. It's worth the investment. Remember, you represent an organization that counts on, you know, its ability to get things done. And that sometimes is going to require the help of the White House and the help of the allies on Congress. And Republicans or Democrats should be amenable to issues of shared concern.
I'll add that, you know, we've got some great fighters for us in the Senate and in the House. And this is not a country controlled by just one White House. We've got, you've got the House, the Senate, and the White House. So everyone's so focused on Trump. The fact is we've got some great senators, whether it's Senator Portman, Senator Rubio, but there's a lot of good people that you can still go through and are still advocates and champions for Jewish causes.
I think if Jewish organizational professionals take a deep breath and get over it, they'll realize that this White House will be a very open door for them. I remember in the first term of the, and you guys will remember better than I do, in the first term of the Bush administration, there was huge skepticism over the faith-based and community initiatives. And by the time Obama rolled into town, there were Jewish federations saying, you better not be getting rid of this because this is an important program. So, because they realized that this was a valuable way to support their efforts in their communities and to help them understand the ways that the federal government and different agencies can work with them on helping those less fortunate and those in need. And so I think you will see a lot of sympathy. He's from New York. He's familiar with federations in the community and more than probably most presidents that have come in. And I think that there will be an open door if the federations want to go in and have a discussion, a dialogue. And I'll tell you, my time as Jewish liaison, I had federations come in and we had great discussions, and I had others that just thought it was their opportunity to yell at someone and throw tomatoes. And you can guess which ones did better at accomplishing what they came there to accomplish.
And to the extent that some Jewish organizations thought that it was the appropriate move to adopt the Obama agenda as the Jewish agenda, I would urge them to start refocusing on what a Jewish agenda should be and see where there are commonalities with this new administration and this new Congress.
All right, this is a wrap up. Thank you so much for watching, for listening.
Would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.